for no gang. Ain't taking no more, let us go for them chains. God bless they soul, every one of them names. Speaking in black and white, it's a problem with the whole way of life. Can't change overnight, but we gotta try some more. Might as well go ahead and start here. We done had a hell of a year. I'ma make it count why I'm here. God is the only man I fear. They training officers, the killers, they shooting protesters with these rubber bullets. They regular.
Welcome to Conscious Reconstruction, aka the show where you get your whole mental readjusted. And this is round two, because round one there was a fire and we had to leave, but we put all of what we had from round one up, and so we're back again to give you everything that we had, we didn't have, and some more shit. And I know the last episode ended on us talking about me being mad about the way that they drug the black man, like, by his arms and just, like, whole body on the ground, and they picked two white guys up. So, yeah. But I know we have science to get into, so I guess we can get back into that.
I don't know where we were, or we just starting the whole thing over?
Yeah, just all the science, because we didn't have any of that. All
right.
Let's see. Oh, robotic dog. So they're developing, or they have developed, a robotic dog that has it's essentially a robotic pet. It has cameras, 360 high def cameras. Its selling price is going for about $74,000, and it's only limited to two per person.
You know, it's not two per household. So if you got enough people, you can still get a robotic army.
I mean, yeah, you're right. But the way you order it, it would be to per customer.
Yeah, I just give all the niggas that need to buy these from me. Hey, come here.
Yeah, there's a way around it.
Gaming the system.
Yeah, we're going to ship all of these to my house.
But yeah, like originally, the thing that drew me to it was the fact that people told people they couldn't have more than two, and they had to promise not to put weapons on it. Because it's quite mobile. It has all the technology I've talked about previously when developing these type of robots, flexible robots that can move and get up over terrain real easily. And I mean, it doesn't have a head. It's like a body with legs, realistically. It's kind of goofy looking.
So no teeth, but, like, I don't know if this made it in last time, but we can put, like, a giant taser on their head and then put a flamethrower inside the middle of it, and things will shake. So you walk up, you tase them, and then you kind of, like, flamethrower.
And
move your mic closer to you.
Closer. Better.
Right. I've also, they're also in development making an arm for it, so it can have a grab reach arm, like pick things up and things along those lines.
Like five of them, actually 10 for real. I'm gonna be real honest with you.
I assume if they're making an arm for it, they'll have other attachments.
10 of them is 740 bands. I don't got 740 bands, but I do need 10 of them. So we gotta figure out a way to get some of these, at least two.
Well, see, that's the useful thing about it is you can just use them to guard your other dogs.
Exactly.
It's just like, why are you here? We are just here guard to your make property. Sure you don't take that dog. Like, it'd be so cute.
The way it looks, like what they really are, they are guard dogs or things along those lines, because they're going to be developed and later on used as security for like buildings and things along those lines. They're robotic, so you ever have to worry about feeding them or anything like that. Their battery will probably be a self-charging running battery on its own, or they have a charging station that they just post in when they're not doing anything.
Interesting. Depending upon who you talk to, some people will look at this as like, oh my goodness, you're getting rid of people jobs.
I need like five of them, but we can start off with two.
I mean,
we gotta buy them under the company. We need to start this company account.
What?
For
which company?
All of them. We just need to start starting though. Yeah. But outside of that, I want one.
This is obvious.
Yeah.
Of all the people he wants in his life. You know,
like I said, this is only the first one, and when you know how we are with technology, nothing's ever. This is essentially just a prototype. It's the first one out here. In probably like 10, 15 years, maybe even sooner than that, you'll probably have like 2 and 3, which are much more advanced than the first one, that can do a lot more stuff than the first one ever thought it could. So, yeah, so they're only going to get more advanced as we go along in the system with them developing them.
Put some wheels on the undercarriage. So that means if people start running away too fast, you can just like fold your legs down and then be like, have your Autobots roll out and chase people down.
That'd be hilarious.
Either that or they just outrun you. It's not. We have the technology to do it. They literally just developed the technology to be able to make robots move at least the speed of cheetahs with the same type of movement cheetahs use to run.
Usain Bolt versus robot. What's gonna win?
Robot. He was only maxed out at 25, maybe 28 miles per hour. Most things that are slow in the animal kingdom are faster than us. So, yeah, we're going to lose. Like, humans don't run that fast compared to everything else. We're quite slow. Even shit like hippos. Hippos run 35 miles per hour. They outweigh us by tons. And we're a lot faster than we even imagine. I'll try to get to. So, astronomers found the youngest star ever. We went through the math and everything with it, but it's, for us viewing it, it's 240 years old. Plus the years it would take, you know, the light years for us to actually see the star itself.
All we know is it's younger than humanity.
Yeah, this is a baby star. This is the youngest thing we've ever seen. And, of course, they're going to keep eye on it and track it to see the development of stars and try to figure that out.
But it's a good thing that lets us know that things are still being created, brand new in our universe.
Yeah, that's enough.
Our galaxy.
The things aren't quite, you know, dying like they believe.
Nope. Things are still popping off.
Yeah. Yeah. All right, so
what, Charles? You don't want things to pop off?
Well, not like I don't want things to pop off. I mean, the opportunity to go to another planet is nice. We Charles. Definitely need cryostasis in order for that to really function, or else we're just going to be living on the. We're going to have multiple generations on the spaceship.
I mean, we have stasis. We just need the cryo part to get down now.
All I know is, Charles, what is your idea to get rid of all the trash on the planet?
Getting rid of all the trash on the planet.
Mm-hmm.
Well, stop producing things that we can't recycle, and then come up with some disposal method for what we have now, and then only use recyclable things from this point forward. The lines are pretty simple. It's just we just won't do it.
What disposable things do you think we can get rid of them?
Well, you'd have your number one, plastic. Mm-hmm.
How do we get rid of the disposable?
Well, styrofoam, really. Like, styrofoam's a terrible thing that we can't really get rid of. And it's difficult to break down.
What I want
to
do is
so is plastic.
To the moon.
Plastic is a lot worse than styrofoam.
Or to Mars.
But we can recycle some forms of plastic.
Or the sun. I think we should jettison all of our trash out.
But he basically pointed out, I never thought about before, we'd have to stop making the trash in the first place.
Well, yeah.
That's the biggest issue in the situation. Because it's like, well, we can start cleaning up trash. We've been cleaning up the oceans and everything for years, decades. But it doesn't matter because we keep producing trash and putting more in there. So us cleaning it doesn't really matter if we just keep producing it.
I mean, as much as people like to complain, like, oh, we need a solution for the trash, it's just like, well, the first step to fixing most things is to stop doing it to begin with.
Yeah, but I get that. But how do we get rid of the trash that we have here?
I mean, you suggest the Futurama method of just get rid of it or build on top of it. But it's like, I don't know if that's going to quite fix it, because it's very costly to send things into space. It ain't cheap.
Yeah, I did the math like a couple months ago with it. It's like some hundreds of thousand or something like that for a kilogram, because of the rocket fuel we use. It'd be easier to do if we had a more efficient fuel source, or something that's not rocket fuel, because rocket fuel is so fucking expensive that it busts pockets just to shoot anything into space.
I mean, ultimately, we could like, if we stop using oil ad nauseum, then oil would go down, so this rocket fuel would go down, but that's still only going to make it so cheap. So, yeah. And our oil consumption has gone down massively anyway.
And the more I think about it now, like I said, we do a pretty good job cleaning shit up. But like I said, it doesn't matter if you clean it up if people keep making a mess.
And like, I understand the people will always say that, oh, well, what about the other countries? We can worry about ourselves and then like bring everybody else in line.
You know, I don't care about the other countries. I just think we need to do something.
Like, personal responsibility, it always starts first with you. Stop pointing the finger at other people.
No one takes personal accountability for anything. But, yeah, that was just I'm trying to figure out how to get rid of all the trash. That's, like, my goal. If I can contribute something to society, that's what it's going to be. Getting rid of all the world's trash.
I mean, the go-to is to just use some biochemistry and basically come up with like a organic thing that consumes the trash, and consumes the things that we actually make, and then toss it into whatever landfills or whatever and have that consume everything. That's like always the go-to thing for people to do, but that's easier said than done. But I feel like we have some bacteria and things like that are already in existence.
We have things that can, but they can't do inorganic materials. That's the thing. Because like, things like glass isn't really an issue. Because glass,
yeah, heat it back up.
Yeah, glass would just turn back into earth eventually when it rotates down into the system. It's stuff like I said, the inorganic things that we create, like plastic, like styrofoam, that stay around and don't ever break down. Like cardboard's batteries. Not an issue. Things along those lines.
Metal's not really an issue. Yeah.
Computers.
All that shit.
Like, I would say computers, but I don't think we really consume enough computers for it to really matter. It's not like computers are mass produced, but they're not mass produced in the same way that styrofoam cups and plastic cups are.
We gotta get rid of cows.
Cows?
Yeah.
Why?
Oh, because they fart a lot and they make a lot of methane.
Yep.
But it's more so just the method in which we are using to create.
Oh, yeah, no, we got to stop doing that.
Oh, I was going to say, the cows definitely are not the issue. It's what we do with the cows.
Yeah, no. I recognize.
But I also think factory farming is the primary thing that's causing the problem. We are the primary thing. Like, shifting this one of those things where it's just like, I understand that's part of the things that we do. But honestly, if we just stop boiling all the oil, burning all the oil in the world, and like do a lot of this stuff, you know what? We can have factory farming.
No, we shouldn't though.
Because like, the earth can take certain things.
We shouldn't have factory farming either though. I feel like we should just get rid of it all.
It's like, we don't, but that's the thing. Everyone treats it as if we need to get rid of everything. We just need to recurtail our overall
tendencies. But we don't need factory farming. Factory farming is wasteful.
Well, it really just kind of depends upon the types of people that you're dealing with.
How many restaurants have you worked at?
Like 3 or 4.
How many times have you seen them just throw away plenty of good food?
Oh, they throw away food. I think that's inherent to the actual organizations themselves. I wouldn't even put that on factory farming. I'll put that on just people being spiteful. Because it's like, they don't want to get, for some reason, they don't want to give the food to their employees. It's just like, why? Like, that's never made any sense to me either. Like, well, we can't give it to you.
It's all money, bro.
I feel like we create too much waste.
And a lot of that, well, I feel like capitalism creates a situation for some reason that they want to, that, like, generates this waste. It is not purely, it's not only capitalism, it's partly human nature, but, like, when you have people who could eat said food and you throw away all said food, then I feel like that's kind of part of the problem. Also,
there are plenty of homeless people in hella cities, and we just like, nah, but all this food, it's going to go in the trash. But what?
Why don't you want to give it away to anybody?
It's money. Because all that shit, all that food they throw away, all that shit that gets thrown away, they sell it to places that use it for compost and things along those lines. So it's all about the money. They make money off of it.
Yeah, I know.
So that's why they do it. I'm not defending it. I'm not saying it's a good thing. But what I'm saying is that that's why it happens, because all that shit just gets sold back into their pockets.
And I'm not really going to complain about it being what it is. It's just, that's it. And it really shouldn't be that way, but for some reason, that's what people care about.
I need the world to be like Cowboy Bebop.
So you need to be, you want to be able to live on Mars and Venus?
No, but just like a global economy where everybody's just like one thing. We just out here trying to make it as a group.
Humanity doesn't face anything to force us together like that.
Come on, asteroid or aliens. But anyway, what's the next science thing that you have? Is it big brain genes?
Yeah, it was a thing about the brains. Man. So
we gonna have talking gorillas that are talking niggas up.
They
Planet of the Apes
discovered the gene that created that allowed our brain to grow the size it did. And they believe it's the gene because they started testing it on certain monkeys and or the embryos because ethics. The gene is called ARHGAP11B. And it's the one that it also triggers the stem cells and whatnot. It's when they use it and inject it into the monkeys, they're using marmosets. And they're injecting into the neural cortex, or the neural cortex. And in the embryos they saw, what would usually happen with anything that's not human, because they don't have this gene, that part of their brain folds and it doesn't become as developed and as big as it is in our mind, in our brain. So their development with certain things, like speech and things on those lines, will stop at a certain point and they'd just be what they are. With this gene, what is believed that could possibly happen, because like I said, they're in Japan, but I guess their ethics only take them so far. Also, what would happen if you were to inject the gene to these marmosets and then allow them to reach full adulthood? It'd be the possibility they have the same comprehension as a human and be able to do the same things we do. They'd just be marmosets, not humans. And I don't know if this gene could be applied to any other animal, because it's a mammal thing. So I don't know if that's, if I don't know if it's, I don't know if this gene is, or they didn't talk about it, I don't know if it's specific to mammals or if this is a everything type gene.
If it's just specific to mammals, just imagine bears getting it.
That's not what we need.
I mean, it might not be what we need, but scientists like to see how they can push the bounds.
Do things. Yeah, they do.
Of the limits.
Yep.
Who? I'm sure there's a scientist out there that wants to be able to communicate with bears.
Mm-hmm. But it's not just that. I'm pretty sure half the biologists out there that deal with animals want to be able to communicate with the animals.
I think it would be so cool to talk with the... Well, you've seen a Rick and Morty sketch about this. We know what the squirrels are out there doing. It's not.
Watch, they're going to give the wolves this shit.
Stop giving things with hunter mentalities these things. We can give it to elephants.
Nah. No, you can't. Elephants are dangerous.
Elephants are dangerous, but yes. I feel like we can get an elephant to be chill.
All right, so you're going to get an elephant to be chill after you sit here and tell them that they get hunted every year. But like ivory, yeah, they're going to gang up on you and beat your ass.
You know what I'll tell them? And then they're going to take over Africa. It's just like, oh.
Because imagine an elephant that can use weapons.
If somebody points a gun at you, yeah, it's literally just for your tusks. Just trample them. I don't care about those people.
They're going to take over the whole continent.
It's like...
But no, I feel like scientists are going to give this to animals that don't need it. And I'm here for it.
Be an interesting world.
Realistically, I want a zombie apocalypse.
I don't want a zombie apocalypse at all.
You know, actually, a zombie apocalypse would be a lot less terrifying than an animal apocalypse.
Why don't you want a zombie apocalypse, Charles?
Because it's unnecessary.
You don't think it'd be interesting? I don't want it until we get to
particularly
like cyborg state though.
You want
it?
It
probably won't
have.
It probably wouldn't be a thing then.
Yeah, see, my thing is
it couldn't be a thing then.
It's like 50-50 with me. It's like that would make the world more interesting. A zombie apocalypse.
But it would just not be a threat at that point though.
But it would also like, no, I mean, without getting to the world of like cyborgs. But then it would also probably stop us getting to the world of cyborgs because, like, certain societies would collapse and science mm-hmm. would be dedicated to, like, curing this. And so that would put a whole damper on that.
Yeah, everything just shifts because this becomes top priority.
Well, you would need biological. Well, you probably...
That's if they couldn't just stomp it out as soon as it happens.
Do you see the way that we can't deal with the flu quickly?
Well, what I mean is, I assume if we have technology to be able to have a cyborg body, you would have the technology to be able to stomp out a virus, because realistically...
I'm saying this would happen before we get to that point of technology.
Oh, yeah, then it would just stop the whole... the whole thing just grind to a halt.
Yeah.
Except for whatever the militaries are doing.
Because there's either... The way I look at it now is either I... let the world be chill until we get to cyborgs, or I want a zombie apocalypse... and we don't get to cyborgs. So I guess I want the world to be chill more than I want a zombie apocalypse.
I don't see the need for a zombie apocalypse.
It just sounds fun.
It's not fun. There's nothing fun about everything going in
we
this
We probably have
dystopia.
Very different ideas of fun. Clearly.
Yeah, it'd be fun.
You see,
I'd have fun.
Marcus said it would be fun. Look at you.
I'd also off be doing my own shit, so you know.
Actually, Ash agrees with you. Has no desire to be in a zombie apocalypse. She is always frustrated with me and Marcus talk about it. So you're not alone.
What's fun about it, though?
The element of survival. This is normal. This normality is predictable.
It's just boring.
Yeah. And who wants to predict everything?
Me.
And then, I mean, you get to like build an empire, and it becomes like country building and state building, and you have your whole little like town and shit.
Except for life doesn't work like a video game.
It doesn't have to work like a video game.
It's quintessentially what that is. It's just like, oh, no, you get to do like country building and state building. It's just
mean, not even country, real country building, but you're gonna build up like a 5-acre little area, fence it off, grow some shit on it, kill zombies when you need to.
And also the inherent disloyalty of humans upsets me inside of this scenario.
That's why you create a vacuum place where you don't allow outsiders and you have a higher tertiary group that is swift to operate from the shadows but also remove any signs of dissidence from the ruling class that's present.
But at that point, you're just going full on totality. You're going full on
yes.
dictatorship.
Yeah, I'm not, because I don't have time to play with you niggas. There's zombies outside. You niggas want to play human games? No. If you want to live inside these walls, these are the laws. And we don't accept outsiders.
See, it's a nice sentiment to a certain degree, but it's also the nature of people. Like, you need certain skill sets, so you're going to have to let people in from the outside at some point.
No.
Like, all right, well, mm-hmm. I'm a carpenter.
No.
But in order for you to actually get access to my skills, you're going to have to let all my boys in.
No.
We'll
learn. We'll figure it out. There's books. There's.
But all these, but getting access to these things acquire risk. And with these risk, so that means it's like, if you have knowledge that comes your way at zero risk, except for dealing with these few new people.
That's not zero risk. That's a higher risk than me figuring out. I'd rather risk a couple people going to get some books and knowledge ourselves than allowing you niggas in, because that's a bigger risk to me. I don't understand. You have a infinite potential to do whatever you want. You're an unknown variable. Me going to this library, there are certain variables that I can account for. And hey, we might lose some people. It might be some zombies there. We might have to take some of those out. We might all not make it back. But I can kind of mitigate those risks. I don't know if you wake up on Sunday feeling like, man, fuck this. I'm out of here. And I'm about to fuck all this shit up. I can't mitigate that.
Well, see, here's the thing. It's like, all right, we need to go out and get these books. All right, that's cool. But other people probably need to go out and get these books as well. So therefore, that's a place of conflict.
I'm going
to
kill them.
See, and at that point, you're ending up inside the exact same situation. Except for you took more risk actually going out and go get the book. Mm-hmm. Because it's like, all right, well, I'm going to kill these people. No questions asked. No,
other people were possibly going to kill me behind my back, and I could be at a disadvantaged position. This one, I'm going in fully prepared that anybody that's standing in between me and the books is getting laid down. We're not talking to you. Now we're asking for the books. We're not sending you off on your way. We're going to kill you. Yeah.
Yeah, that's typically not a sentimentality that I'd like to have. It's like,
I mean, but if I'm in a zombie apocalypse, it's not about what I like to have anymore. It's about me making sure that the survival of my encampment that I've created and its future is going to be going for it. Realistically, for the next 10 years, I'm going to keep it enclosed, isolated, and let people breed. And, well, I said breed, but have babies and shit like that. And then I'm going to start talking to them about how expansion is going to probably be met with conflict. And so we're going to have to start working on training. And their kids will be about around 10, 11, shit like that. So a perfect time to start getting into this legion that I'm going to create. And then we're going to come up with a concept that all boys and women and girls are born into the Legion, and they serve 5 years in the Legion doing scouting missions and shit like that. And then they can move up into like other rank positions and things like that, depending on their skill. And that's how we'll advance.
At that point, you also have to understand. Well, see, that's another thing. Because, like, all right, having kids, it's like all the thing about it is inside of this situation, all these things inspire such a ridiculous amount of risk to the point where I wouldn't rather be there to begin with. Because it's like, all right, well, we need to breed and have kids. Well, that's a risk.
I'm mad at this. You sound like Ash. Ash is like, no, just kill me.
It's like, no, I'm not going to say just kill me. If I'm inside the situation, I'll probably flourish in the situation. I have the knowledge base to flourish inside of this situation. But I would still just rather not be inside the situation. I can defend myself. I would still prefer not to. I can build things. I'm capable of building things for fun.
Yeah, see, and that's why you would be one of the homies inside of the
hierarchy. I understand electrical. The hierarchy. I understand all of these things.
And that's why I already know I have a good friend group that has a pretty good basis of the skills.
It's one of those things where I still would rather not be inside of this situation.
But we can make it work.
Inside a situation, I can make most things work.
So, Charles, would you, if it happened, would you hold me down and be a part of the empire?
I mean, at the end of the day, see, that's the thing. I don't want to be in a zombie apocalypse, but if I'm with a zombie apocalypse, there is an acquisition model that we have already laid out, and we laid this out inside of high school. There are certain people that you go pick up, and there's certain people that you don't go pick up. If you don't have an actual useful skill, you're not getting picked up.
It's very true.
It's just like, Man, I can't really even, like, there were certain people, like, Jesus Christ, I can't, Cat, like, yeah, like in high school, Cat, I would have never picked her up.
No.
Left exactly where she is. You have nothing.
Man, I already got the setup. I got these two backpacks. I'm gonna put my front backpack.
I guess sewing
with my handgun and all of my bullets and everything like that, and some provisions. I'm gonna have my backpack on. I'm gonna have them both tied so that way it's like a rucksack. So that way it's not too much outward weight. I'm gonna have my shotgun ready, and then I'm gonna go take over a small area real quick after I hit the gun store.
And like,
that's, I'm gonna let the other people panic, and I'm gonna go straight to the gun store.
And it's like, but you're not gonna be the only person with that idea, and there's gonna be choke points in certain areas. Like, the first place I go to is Home Depot, because raw materials are technically the largest.
That's where I'm going. I'm taking over Home Depot. I'm taking over Severance.
That is a very difficult to defend area, because there's a lot of open space.
All you gotta do is block off all the entrances to Severance and set the surrounding little apartment complexes on fire. And while all that's happening, people are like afraid and confused. That's when you get to work building a little compound.
It's a possibility, but it also kind of depends upon where people are when it pops off and how people respond, because it's very possible that instead of the police being everywhere else, the apartment building being set on fire might draw the police near you.
Or we take over this area over here. Just take over these other two houses and fence everything off.
I need something.
Take this whole street.
See, the lack of access to water.
We have well water.
Oh, you guys have well water?
Yeah, you have a well water, so we would just go to Home Depot, steal all the salt, steal pallets of salt, and we'd have clean water.
And then, what else is there?
We got hella land we can grow on.
Yeah, but you also need people who are skilled in growing things.
Jones is a grown master Z.
Farming, long-term farming is a lot different from Jess.
But Jones wants to get into long-term farming.
Didn't I know you? How to long-term farm.
You see?
It's really not as difficult as you make it out to seem.
Because it's like, I know there's rotational
yeah, plots. It's rotational things. It's rotational plots. It's rotational seasoning. But, like, things along those lines, I don't care about things like that, because the stuff that I do doesn't have to fall into rotational anything because of the way I grow stuff. That was the whole point of me creating soil. I literally with
we got the builder in you, we got the farm
with the so like okay, the, for the example streets. With we the soil the I street. Created, I literally could set a box up on top of concrete and just start growing, and I'd be fine.
We taking over this street.
Oh,
I could grow anywhere.
We shutting this whole street down, putting fences up behind all the backyards. We gonna corral some deer.
Granted, I'm just going to teach and leave, because I have a whole other plan when it comes to me being in the apocalypse.
Yeah, he's going to Brazil.
So he's just you're going to abandon us?
He's going to get us set up, and then he's going to go to Brazil, and that's fine.
Why would he go to Brazil?
He wants to live in the Amazon.
Why would you want to live where lots of things can kill you?
I mean, it's not like I'm leaving anywhere where things aren't trying to kill me anyways. I'd rather deal with animals than people. Animals are a lot more predictable.
And then you still have people. There are indigenous people in the Amazon.
Yeah, I know. But I know that if I stay the fuck away from them, they won't come after me. They are all about territorial-based things. You stay off their land, they're not fucking with you. That's how people go into Amazon now.
Yeah, so that's where he wants to be, in Amazon. So
I'm not going.
That's not where we're going. We just go take this whole street.
That's why I said I.
Bring your family. Pick a house. Everybody in these houses got to go. That's enough said on that. We ain't got to explain how, but got to go.
You pretty much just have to build an entire territory, and then you also have to build it, so it means it is defensible.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that's the difficulty, and that's also part of the reason why I don't like dealing with zombie apocalypses. It causes me to do a whole bunch of things that my morality would not really want me to do.
But see, for me, the zombie apocalypse doesn't really bother me in the sense that all it would do is force me to go do something I want to do anyways.
Yeah, me too. That's what it realistically is forcing me to do.
Yeah, I'd rather live out in nature away from civilization and people. I don't really care for most normal touches that people care for. I'm perfectly fine with just me. I could be out in the tree somewhere and be cool.
Oh, I don't mind being alone. It's just more so...
It's not even being alone. It's just being away from civilization.
For me, it is one of those things where I look at it and the things that the zombie apocalypse is going to force me to do are things that I don't particularly want to do. Like, I don't want to have to cut someone's head off. But at some point, I'm probably going to have to do it.
All I know is
I'm
going to try and demolish all the other houses that aren't on this street, like the street over on both sides, and that way create like just like pits and everything like that, whole street long pits as defensive bottoms and things like that. And so that way you can either attack us from the front or the back, because there's that other street and it's probably gonna be a lot harder to break up the concrete than it is to be able to go through the dirt that's already been like prepped for like building and shit. So,
The nitty gritty of these things is very annoying. And then you also, there are so many skill sets that you actually need in order for a place to really function. Like, you would need a doctor. You would need
Brendan.
Brendan's not a doctor.
His family. Brendan's a biologist. We're bringing his family.
Brendan's family is getting up there.
Yeah, but the dad could teach Brendan the skills that he needs. Where you can go back to the way that skills were actually taught, and not in a fucking classroom where you read a book for 12 years and then you go get some practical skill. Brendan's going to be learning and getting the practical skill and actually getting a much deeper understanding of it. It'll be fine.
See, that's the thing. And also, like, being a doctor is so specialized to the point where it's just like...
You're going to have families that do these things.
But it's
being specialized in a situation, you still have to have the base skills of a doctor, and then you go skills. Off into your specialization.
Go into your specialization.
We would have everybody learn first aid and basic like health things.
But it's like,
I mean, and then realistically, inside this situation, if you want to get down to the nitty gritty and all the real true shit, if you're in a situation like this, if you get busted to a point that you can't do anything, I can't do anything for you. If my doctors can't do anything for you, we can't do anything for you. You're going to die. Yeah. And that's just what it is. Because at this point, there's no extra shit keeping us alive. We're in nature. We're in the wild. So you're to the...
And that's the risk you just got to be willing to take.
We just roll back to pre-civilization.
Yeah, the medieval
people
times.
Would be all right.
And this is also the reason why I don't like zombie apocalypse.
Come on, Charles.
Because all these caveats all these things is just like... It forces you to be okay with just abandoning people.
This is a tangent.
It's not being okay with it. It's being... I don't want to argue about it.
It's like you have to be able to accept
it. That's what I said. This is a tangent. What else do we have in science?
The only other thing I had was Neanderthal brains being grown.
Oh, my garden of Neanderthal brains.
Why would you want to grow a garden from of stem cells
and DNA?
I just said that I wanted to grow one. I said that there is one.
I'm not talking about you. I'm talking about in general. Why go for Neanderthal brains? You could have just grew a bunch of human brains and then used it as like a chain computer. And then did it that way. You know how much computing power the human brain has?
What if they found out Neanderthals were smarter than humans?
That should be hilarious. I mean, what if that part, that certain gene in our mind came from Neanderthals?
Yeah.
I mean...
Us breeding with them, and that's how we got intelligence.
Well, they said they highly believe that Neanderthals didn't just disappear. They just crossbred with humans. And, like, I could believe it. You could see a couple people walking around looking like whole-ass Neanderthals. Like, nigga, you don't look like a person.
Look at that brow.
I don't know. from what I understand, in terms of the human DNA, there are different groups that have bred off from different.
Yeah. I mean, realistically, if there were... There's a
clear delineation of those who came from Africa as opposed to those who came from Northern Europe.
Mm-hmm.
It's just like, that's the reason why we're not particularly hairy or a whole bunch of other things.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it's completely possible that it, in a sense of that time, where you'd have things like Neanderthals, and you don't have what we have nowadays. You can't just travel the way we do. You can't just cross paths and everyone would just intermingle. So a group of humans being cut off from everybody for like 200-300 years would become their own species. If you're not crossing with any other humans, you're almost biologically different from the one that's across the ocean, because your environment's going to change you. You're running within evolution. You're not running within any other things that are going to affect you. It's just environment and nature and whatever's out there. So it's very possible that you have things like Neanderthals, and you have Homo sapiens, then you have Devonians and things along those lines. And the more we mingled, the more we came across each other, we all just bred up to become what we are now. Or they all just bred out, and their DNA is just left within Homo sapiens. Because if you go by terms of evolution, then you have things like Neanderthals, you have things like them, like I was saying, or any of the pre-humans or pre-Homo sapiens, whatever, for whatever reason, they couldn't survive. They weren't adapted. They weren't that far in evolution, and their evolution chain stopped them right here, and we can't go any further. So you die out. But there was a chance they could have bred with a Homo sapien at some point in time, and that still lives within us. It'd be a very small amount because they were gone after a while. But the trace would still be there. And that's probably how they got their hands on Neanderthal DNA. Yeah. Unless they found frozen ones, which we have, I'm pretty sure.
Fuck the Neanderthals.
Yeah.
It's all about us humans. We are the supreme ones. No, I'm fucking with y'all. We're pretty trash for real. But I do want a Neanderthal brain garden. I don't have a reason why that I want it, but I think that it might be interesting just to have one. Like, hey, you want to see my Neanderthal brains? You have Neanderthal brains? Yeah. They just came into season.
They just came into season.
Yeah. I mean, if I'm growing them, then they must have a season. And just grow all the time. I mean, unless they do, and then that's unique. I'm not mad at it. I'm not happy with it. I want to talk about my Neanderthal season. The brains are looking so lovely this time of year. They're so plush and gooey.
Okie dokie.
Charles is not here for this. But I guess we can get on to what I had to talk about. And I just got a new topic that I'm going to add. So before I get into my real topics, we can get into this quick one. It's about relationships.
Okay.
Yeah. So how do y'all feel about the way mental health is addressed or even considered when it comes to dating and men dealing with women and women dealing with men?
I mean, one of the age-old idioms that I've ever learned from people was don't stick your dick in crazy. For the most part, it stands up.
Okay. That's a...
It's like...
That is a perspective.
And also, don't allow crazy dick to stick you. It works both ways.
How do you know they're crazy?
You know, if you have it, if you can't possibly tell, you should probably date them a bit longer. It's like,
what if they don't seem crazy while you're dating them?
If they're not crazy, so after you're married.
Man, at that point, I feel like I got into the wrong marriage, and I'm going to make sure it's like, they're going to slip at some point because they're crazy.
I don't know, man. The craziest people are quite sane.
That's what?
Mm-hmm. Meaning they're like they're really
dedicated to their crazy thought.
Yeah. Or if they have a goal or something along those lines, it's really easier for them to do it than other people. Because you feel morals, you feel some type of guilt or betrayal behind it, and they probably won't. They probably don't care.
Doesn't matter so, if they divorce
so,
them.
So it's not hard to hide it.
Like, as it stands, I can understand. I don't view marriage as, like, I would ideally like to do it once, but if you purposely, like, deceive me to get me to marry you, I'm not going to stay here.
I mean, that's understandable. I didn't think you'd do so.
So, it's like, and I'm probably the type of person who will make that very clear from the beginning. So, I don't see myself getting in that situation.
Okay.
Do you, all right, so what if they're not crazy? What if they just have a mental health issue? Well, do you immediately discount them for dating?
No. I've dated people with depression and so on and so forth.
No.
How do you deal with that?
Depends upon the levels of depression. The first thing I always tell them to do is that you have to have a counselor or a psychologist or something. Like, you need somebody because I know how these things work. And I understand that I cannot be the person that is your sole sounding board. Can't happen. It cannot happen.
Why not?
Because it's not a good idea. It's like it puts a ridiculous amount of stress on me and thus puts more stress on a given relationship. And it kind of... My uncle gave me this term and it's like, it doesn't quite apply inside of this, but... It's like, all right, well, both people have to be given 100% at all times to a relationship because if both people just give 50%, if one person falters, you're at 90% and the entire thing falls apart. Because relationships function at 100% or kind of, or they don't. And you get mired. But, so I look at it like that. It's just like, I can't be your sole and exclusive warden for your mental health. I can't. Because that's going to put a lot of stress on me, and that's going to shift the focus of our relationship to the point where this relationship isn't about us. It's about your mental health. And it's like, I can do some of that, and I can be understanding about it, and you can talk to me, but I can't be the sole arbiter of it. You got to have someone else. And I'm not even saying your friends. Like, you need somebody who is professional and good at dealing with these things, and along with you got to stay on your meds and all this other stuff, because a lot of people just go off their meds and that's always really, really annoying. Like, Jesus Christ, stay on your meds.
Maybe their meds make them feel weird,
but that's the thing. The condition that you're in is the abnormal state. So the way you're currently feeling, whether it be manic or whether it be depressive, that's the abnormal state. And getting someone to actually understand that is the difficult thing. And that's always where you end up fighting. Because it's like, it makes me feel weird. It doesn't make me feel myself. But your regular self is depressed or manic. You're either up or you're down. You, like, the entire point of medication is to kind of, like, sand off those rough parts. And that's not how it is always for everybody, but for a lot of people, that's kind of what the medication does. It makes the lows a lot less low, and it makes the highs a lot less high.
I mean, yeah. But what if they don't have medication? What if they're not on medication? What if they're not at that stage?
I understand this is probably going to sound super cruel, but at that point, it's just like, should you probably really be looking super hard at getting in relationships right now? Like, maybe I'm crazy, but if like, maybe if we get married and I have health care and then you gain access to the health care and that's the way you get right, yeah, maybe that's the route that we have to take towards this. But like, we gotta have a plan, because it just can't be me, because I've tried it before, it doesn't work.
Well, no, I don't advocate it for it just being you. But I mean, do you think that they can work on those issues and be in a relationship at the same time?
Can they work on both?
Well, I don't see why not. Have to.
But you're gonna be super strained.
Yeah. So what are your opinions of dating women like that, Marcus?
I mean, I don't really have an issue with it. Dating women that were on pills or that wasn't. Have depression.
Don't move your knee when I try to rub knees with you.
I didn't realize that I moved. I thought you just brushed past me, to be honest. I didn't realize you actually touched me on purpose.
Don't be running away. Charles, I'm going to get you tomorrow.
What?
Don't worry about it.
But yeah, like, I've dated women across the spectrum with all types of fucking issues when it came to mental disability and things along those lines. And like I said, it was never really a factor, or even when it got bad, it wasn't really that bad, at least not to me. Yeah, I could see where you can get some strain from it sometimes. Sometimes it should get rough. But I mean, that all depends. Even then, I feel like that all depends on falls on how you are as a person also, or just the type of person you are. And not saying, not discounting anybody for anything that they do or how they deal with situations. But like, me personally, I can deal with a lot more shit than most people can deal with. So it doesn't bother me to go to those lows or things along those lines and help you up out of that. If like medicine or something along those lines aren't your choice, because I can understand not taking medicine. I don't ever want to take medicine from anything, ever. And it's not because they're doing what they're doing or they make me feel weird. It's because when it comes to me and like feeling some type of way about it, or feeling it's not it affecting me emotionally or doing what it's supposed to do, it's the feeling of it making me sick. In the sense of, like, I'm having a reaction to it or something along those lines. I'm not for pharmaceuticals and side effects and the bullshit that comes along with them.
Side effects are always diarrhea, something, death.
Mm-hmm. What's your crazy side effects?
It's yeah. Just like...
I'm like, I don't see why.
They always go from, like, the mundane, like, diarrhea, upset stomach, yada, yada, yada. Get, like, gastric entonitis. I'm sorry, what? Death.
Yeah, like, how do we get to death?
If you have an erection for more than so many hours, seek your doctor, and it's just like, what is going on?
Actually, your penis won't even get hard anymore. We're sorry. It's like, actually, you know, I don't take any of this.
Right. I think I'll just deal with this. But, like I was saying, like, I don't really have an issue with talking to people that have a disorder or something along those lines. Unless it's like an extreme disorder and you just always wallowing the fuck out, I can't deal with that. I can't deal with a situation where you like schizo or something along those lines and you just flipping out every 2 seconds. That's too much. Because then that means I physically have to do things and that's a lot.
Yeah, you have to be
that's like this type of stuff that, in my mind, you need to be somewhere dealing with that. You shouldn't be out here dealing with normal people. You need to get that shit together. But like, just things that, and it's sad to say, like things that are normal, like depression and bipolar and things along those lines, that things like that don't bother me. Because I can either relate or I can deal with it. So that's my...
about you, Tony?
Feeling on that?
I have an issue dating women with a mental illness or anything like that. As long as you're willing to acknowledge and address it.
Mm-hmm. So I don't really care what stage you're in, if you're at the taking medicine stage, if you're in a position where you don't want to take medicine, well, don't want to take medicine or you can't afford to. As long as you're willing to like acknowledge and take whatever steps are available to you to address it, then I'm with it.
Yeah, you can't just be out here ignoring it, act like it's not a thing.
Yeah.
Especially if you're aware that's a thing. Now, I've come across people who weren't aware that it was a situation, or they weren't aware something was wrong, and then they became aware. But outside of that, you can't just be out here knowing what you're doing and doing it. Doing all, nah. Mm-hmm.
But yeah, no. So for me, I don't have a real issue with it, except for when you're unwilling to acknowledge that you have an issue. Then it's like, well, we really can't move past this point because you're unwilling to acknowledge that things are an issue for you, and that issue is outside of our issues, and is creating ancillary issues for me and you. And some people aren't to that point, so they can't, like, view that or see that. Then I'm not with it. But other than that, I don't think that discounts anybody for me wanting to be, like, invested in them. Because they could be a dope person. And everybody got a little issues here and there.
Yeah.
Shit, Charles, your big toe is, like, 3/4 too small.
No.
You be losing balance all the time.
I mean, my middle toe is longer, but that's just like a matter. That is just a matter of actual genes.
Imagine you start looking at your toes like, well, my big toe seems normal, but my middle toe, if you want to, you know, call it out.
This is the long one, right?
Some people aren't like averse to feet like you are. You're pure hatred of feet. You hate it.
Feet are bad for you.
They're terribly useful.
That's not indicative of how good they are for you.
I want to know what caused you to hate feet so much.
They're ugly. Yeah, I don't know. They just make me feel weird. And they're mostly ugly and like fat, little squashy things. Yeah. But enough of my hatred of feet, because we don't need to talk about that for real. We can go on to talk about a No Name's hatred for J. Cole.
Oh.
And Twitter trying to cancel J. Cole and Kendrick. And then Top Dog saying that they can't have Kendrick album no more because niggas don't appreciate him.
That hoes.
We had this discussion like a few days back, and now this is developed even further.
Yeah.
Because now there's a whole response.
Yeah, because niggas feel away.
Do they?
Clearly J. Cole's album,
right.
The album head for his label was like, you niggas can't have shit because you niggas are ungrateful.
I mean,
J. Cole and No Name have exchanged words over songs.
Didn't she do the same thing that she just called him out for doing in the song though?
Yes. It's like there's no real way that you can look one way or
you
another.
Literally just did the same thing that he did, that you complained about in your song that he did.
Yeah.
So if that was the case and you're really an issue, why'd you even respond? That's my thing. Like, if it was more like, if you was really going for what you was going for, I'm not saying she not. Maybe it's just a, like people were saying with Cole, it was a bad situation. It was a bad move. In my mind, this was a bad move because you just turned into a hypocrite doing the exact same thing she was bashing him for.
My thing is, you had the time enough to go on Twitter and compose this and put this out into the world. But then you want to belittle him going and making a song and responding to it. You put something out into the world about me, and I felt like it was inaccurate, so I responded to it.
I will never accept the fact that that tweet wasn't about them. That was a vague booking thing. And if you don't know what vague booking is, it's talking about someone without directly addressing what someone actually is directly addressing someone. I'll just say that I always count that as kind of like a cowardly act, unless there are some legal repercussions that can be taken because you're not actually legally allowed to talk about them. But if you're going to sit there and kind of fence it, like, I didn't say anything about, and I'm not even attacking her particularly. I'm talking about that entire type of thing. It's like, it annoys me when LeBron does it. It's just like, come on, just call him out. Just do what you need to do.
No, he's a great fence sitter.
But like I said, like, it just, I just the way it elevated and ended up where it's at now, it's just, it seems like you started to focus more about the song and what was said than what your initial reasoning for saying this was in the first place. Because like I said, if that was the case and that's how you really felt, you shouldn't even respond and you should have went about your business doing whatever you were doing. Because, I mean, like I said, he didn't, like, everyone heard the song, he didn't diss you, he didn't assault you or anything like that. So, if you felt responsible was what you felt was, it's just real funny to me. That in the midst of all the shit going on and all the issues that we're dealing with, on top of your issues that come along with all this, because you're dragging the other black problems into the issue too, which I'm not against. Do you really have time to sit up here and make a song about somebody else? This ain't like a waste of time.
Meh.
Yeah. I don't know. I think it's weird that Twitter hopped on this bandwagon to want to cancel.
No, it's fucking because Twitter and the whole cancel culture ride on whatever. If something sounds bad, they're going to hop on it and they're going to try to run shit down.
Oh, that's
and,
also a thing. Cancel culture is not really a thing.
Yeah, right. And don't nobody care because realistically, they're going to hush, they're going to root, hop, hurrah, do all this extra shit for nothing because you're going after people, especially the two people you're going after who have history in all this shit that you're talking about that make music that addresses all this, that were actually out there protesting when all this was going on. So, like,
the critique falls short when you can actually take a look at what they're doing and you see them at protests and things of that nature.
Exactly. So it's like Twitter mostly just motherfuckers that don't know what they're talking about, just hopping on the bandwagon and riding the whole situation. Because as soon as the situation died, they're going to disperse and go find something else to talk about and yell about and be mad about.
But the other thing I will say, it is also not cool to go back and call her a bitch and all that other stuff. Like, the J. Cole fans were, like...
I mean, he can't control his fans. You can't be, like, realistically, you...
I'm not blaming J. Cole for the people, but mm-hmm. I'm saying the people who did that are also wrong. Like, that is equally as problematic. Because it's, like, it's kind of an ad hoc fallacy. Because you can't see any fault with the person, so you can't see fault with the argument, so it means you start attacking the person, when the fault in the argument is very self-evident. It's, like... And that's all you really had to say. It's just like, I don't know. They're out there and they're doing stuff. What are you doing? It's just like, oh, well, I'm also about this thing. It's just like, well, why is there a problem? And that's kind of where the conversation should have ended.
Yeah, but instead we never got there.
Right. And then there's also certain people that kind of don't make sense to be look at them and like, Kendrick, why aren't you saying anything? I don't say anything about anything on social media ever. You get one tweet when an album comes out or a single.
I don't know. The more I think about it, it makes me feel like it wasn't even about what she was bitching and complaining about in the first place. It's about some other shit.
I have withheld myself from calling it clout chasing or anything like that. Because...
Yeah, she did put out a song in response.
That's what I'm saying. Like, as much as you do, I don't want to call it cloud chasing, but that's realistically what it looks like you're doing. Because it's mainly who you targeted. That shit's wild. There's plenty of people in the rap game you could have went after that actually
don't say anything or do anything or have nothing to do with any of this, but you chose the two that do? I don't understand. Well, I don't even get it.
It's also that you chose the two that are considered to be the that are the most critically acclaimed and probably the two most popular pure rappers inside the entire game, which you kind of fancy yourself to be, so you want to be held inside of the same regard with these people, so thus you go after these people. It just kind of rings as disingenuous. It's like, I don't...
Yeah, like that. Pretty much. That's how I feel about it the more I think about it. It doesn't seem like it had anything to do with what we're actually talking about.
I arrived there pretty quickly, but it's like... It seems to run counterintuitive to who she is, but I... Because it's like, apparently she's been on the social justice train for a while. This isn't new for her.
Man, but at the same time, that's like... That's the same thing when it comes to... I be talking to somebody, it's like, oh, this person said this, this, and that. And that doesn't fucking excuse your actions and the things you're actually doing. It doesn't excuse the other bullshit that you do. Just because you're doing something doesn't mean you get away with doing this.
Yeah, and that's
fine. That's why all these fucking rich white people are getting locked up right now. Just because you did all this doesn't mean you're excused from doing the fuck shit that you had in the shadows. So like, just because you're preaching and you're marching for us, which is a great thing, doesn't mean you get to get away with doing dumb shit. So, like, all that falls into the same category to me.
That's ultimately the thing that I was more so going to say. It's just like, just because you're doing good things over here doesn't mean your bad things can't
be. Because, I mean, you can take somebody that's at the top of the black pinnacle in the situation, and someone we look at as a great person. That's fine and dandy, but if you're doing trash on the side, you still about to get knocked down.
I mean.
And then I also look at this as, like, kind of in the same vein as Kyrie said, like, you calling out these other rappers at this point, it's just like
stupid,
becoming a distraction,
yeah,
to the main issue of what we should be focused on. The people that are working, the people that are doing the work, the people that are out there, which happens to include the two rappers that you called out, but we're not gonna talk about that. But we should just focus on that and not create these other distractions. And so I just think it's similar to like the Kyrie being like, I don't want to play basketball. And I kind of disagree with LeBron and feel a way about people who are like, oh, back in the civil rights movement, there was sports going on and we were still able to do things. Yeah, but just because that was how we did things doesn't mean it's how we should do things.
This is absolutely true. It's like, selfishly, I want the NBA season to go on. Unselfishly, I can see the argument to a point where we, as African Americans and as the NBA being a majority African American league, we should probably say, hey, we should chill on this.
I mean, realistically, I never wanted the NBA to start back up in the first place.
Or if they do start back up, how many teams are in the NBA? 32,
36? 32.
Majority of them are black.
If there's 32 teams in the NBA, that means that there's 32 billionaires. These teams should start putting pressure on these billionaires. Oh, you want us to play? Then we need you to see you, the 32 billionaires, put pressure on politicians, actually force legislative change, because that's what lobbyists do. They throw money. So we need y'all to actually affect change if you guys want us to increase your valuations and pockets. I mean, if you want us to play and you want the season to continue, that's something you can do to get it started. Actually be a working, and I say that you're going to, I need it to happen before I step on the court, because once I start playing, then it's all out the window.
I mean, in terms of NBA teams, I don't know, there are definitely people who do have the money to have actual major political clout. Where I look at like NFL teams, I honestly would say it was kind of the inverse. But then again, it's just like, I don't know, one of our most vocal outspoken coaches, which is Greg Popovich, his owner actively donates to the Trump campaign. So like,
yeah,
people,
that's why you force him now. Now you force him. Do you want to continue making money? Because most of your team is black. So,
well, the problem is for a lot of NBA teams, these things are like the very, the teams are like the very, very nice Lamborghini that you have inside of the driveway. It's like, it's nice. It's something that you show off, but you never really needed it. Like for Dan Gilbert, he never really needed the Cavs.
No one's going to want to lose him.
That, I feel like that's irrelevant in the whole situation. Because, you don't want to lose your Lamborghini, but that Lamborghini. You can't even call it a Lamborghini because, I mean, it's making money for you. Lamborghini don't sit in a driveway and make money. Regardless if you, how much money you make from the team and how much you pay, you're making money off the team.
Yeah.
That's why you bought it. So, in that sense, like, even then, you're going to start, if no one's playing, even if the NBA opens back up and no one's playing, what are you going to do? You can't make them play, so you're going to lose money.
Well, I mean, the show up is, like, I do believe showing up to the bubble league is completely and totally optional, but.
But my thing is, no, even with that, what, Florida's having record cases?
Yeah.
Day after day? How safe is the bubble league?
Depending upon what people are actually doing and their employees and how they actually deal with it, it could be fairly safe or not safe at all, depending upon the way they actually deal with it. If all the employees are basically working at Disney and then going into isolation in Disney and not leaving Disney and having the food brought in, and you're going through the proper sanitizing and the correct processes, this can be done inside of a way where more than likely no one will actually pull COVID in. If it's done incorrectly, then obviously people need COVID. Like, it's a possibility. So, yeah. But I don't think Disney's opening back up anytime soon. It's not going to be open while we're running this bubble league.
No.
So.
But.
I'm just kind of like, yeah. I don't know. When I look at Kyrie, I also kind of look at it as a position of, I don't know, like, you're not in the. The thing, I always look at it like, it's like, you're saying this, but you don't have a stake in the game. Because you're not, you already said, I'm injured, I'm not showing up, I'm not doing any of these things, and no one else should play either.
Pat Bev said something.
Pat Bev, I do believe, said, we're all going to do what LeBron does.
Dwight Howard said something.
And no
one. Pat was being fucking sarcastic.
What?
Pat Beverly was being sarcastic.
I'm pretty sure Pat doesn't want to play.
He definitely is being sarcastic. He said, we're going to do everything LeBron does. If y'all took that for word, I don't know who y'all knew was Pat Beverly. But that's not the Pat Beverly I know. Y'all crazy if y'all thought he was actually serious when he said, we're going to do what LeBron does.
I mean,
he meant that in the way that LeBron sits on top of the league and everybody kisses his ass and follows him. So if LeBron wants to play, everyone's going to play. That's what Pat Bev actually meant in that statement.
It's one of those things where, I don't know, I read it as exactly what he said. I try not to read as much into things because it leads me down roads. And I'm inherently pessimistic about things. So it's just
but,
like.
But it's Patrick Beverly.
Yeah, it's Patrick Beverly. And it's just like, but you shouldn't give people quotables that could, that the tone, where tone is kind of the primary like thing that conveys your point. You should say everyone kisses LeBron James's ass.
No, because you say that, now you look bad in the situation. It fucks with your image. You still have to keep some type of professionalism about it. You can't just get online and start bashing fucking people. That's how you get fucked up and kicked out. At that point,
there is still a more eloquent way of saying what you said.
It's just, I mean, like, he did it the same way.
The way LeBron goes. If LeBron doesn't play, a lot of other people won't play, and I feel like the dominoes will fall that way. But if LeBron plays, more players will probably be active because, you know, he's a leader in the league.
Okay.
So, and that's a Democrat.
Within the same vein, though, like, I don't care anymore.
Pat Bev doesn't say shit like that. But regardless, the sports part of that is irrelevant. I just want to talk about the fact that it's a distraction, what they're doing, talking about, well, going back and forth on songs, if that's what No Name wants to do. Like, you can't say, oh, we're not paying attention, and then also put out a song. Like, right. Those two things don't go together.
Well, I don't think J. Cole's going to release another song.
Me neither. I doubt it. Yeah, he said, I said what I said in a tweet before she even released a song, because they were all upset. Oh, this is about No Name. He said, I said what I said, and it's about who it's about. And I'm assuming that is him being done with the situation.
Mm-hmm.
And you're never going to get a response out of Kendrick, because that's not who he is.
And you niggas might have cost me an album, you little bum-ass, bitch-ass niggas. I hate you.
That was Kendrick's response.
Hate you, nigga.
Y'all not getting an album?
I hate you.
so much.
Please don't. I want the album.
Yeah, I didn't do anything wrong. But you fuck niggas gotta talk shit.
You can send it directly to my house and like,
it's just like y'all niggas can't act right, so don't nobody get it.
I'll even sanitize it. I'll send you the envelope.
Yeah. But my secondary question, how do we do better in treating our black women?
Well, we can use the prior situation as an example. The dudes who kind of went off because they're J. Cole fans are like, yo, this bitch don't know what the fuck she talk about. She a hoe. She don't know shit. She only 19 years old. What the fuck she know? Yada, 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 blah, blah, blah. That's not the way you deal with these types of situations.
Yeah, we should chastise them.
Yeah, they didn't have to do that. Even if that's how they felt, they didn't have to say it that way.
Yeah, because J. Cole didn't respond that way. So
right.
Take note from the nigga that you guys claim to love.
Well, oh my goodness. It's just like, I don't know. It's like the AFD niggas who be following, who follow J. Cole are real weird. And if you don't know what I mean by AFD, it's Ashy Fake Deep. It's people who are very, very shallow who think they are very, very deep.
I hate that group of J. Cole.
Well, yeah, I know.
Also known as Hope Gems.
Are up under Cole, a lot more of them under Cole than they are any close to Kendrick.
The Pulitzer Prize winning writer. And the other person is J. Cole.
But even in that same situation, you can't blame a man for his fans. It's not his fault that they decide they want to rally up under him in their fandom.
Yeah, I understand that. But you can also check your fandom.
Yeah. Yeah, you can say, check your fandom.
Hey, don't attack her. She doesn't deserve that. Like, you guys need to check your feelings. And it's just like, if I don't feel that extreme about it, why do you guys?
But in the other vein, we always see plenty of fandoms just go on the ravenous attack, like the Navy, the Beehive, the Barbs. Niggas are afraid of those ones.
That's the thing.
I have no idea who the Barbs
Nikki.
Are.
Nicki Minaj's fans. Because she's Barbie.
Yeah.
So they're the Barbs. The Navy is Rihanna. The Beehive is Beyonce. Yeah.
I mean, I know the Beehive. I didn't know.
I'm going to say, even then, and
I'm surprised Rihanna still has a large fan base. Rihanna hasn't given us any actual.
Yeah, but
you know what?
Her fan base doesn't care about her music like that. Well, they do. I'm not going to say
that.
They're
really upset that she won't release music.
But
she released Fenty Beauty, which is like makeup for black women that has highlights and colors and shades that are actually for them, that fit them. And then she also released Savage lingerie line for women and everything like that. So her women and her core still being fed if it's not through music.
But
I would like some music. I'm not going to lie. I'd appreciate it. I would say thank you and please.
But it's one of those things where I look at it, it's just like, okay, well, how about we not attack and belittle and do things of that nature? Like, just because someone attacks you inside of that way, like, get rid of the online dunk culture thing, because it's kind of, that is toxic. That's just like trying to make your point at the cost of someone else, because your point really isn't all that great to begin with. Like, that's
half of them weren't, half people, like, in that sense, weren't even making points, they're just being emotional. But I do feel like that is one of the steps we could take to, begin treating our black women a lot better. And like, realistically, the more I think about it, it's a cultural thing, and we need to start, like, even if you, however you grew up, however you were raised, women, however your household was, you still have them as respect as somebody else, as another person. Regardless of how you feel about them, they're still another human being. You should be able to respect them the same way you would look at this other type of woman who might not be black. You shouldn't, and there's no reason you should feel any different about her opposed to this white woman or this Asian woman. Or
realistically, what we need to talk about is how niggas have whole ass resentment towards their mother and the women that they're raised around, and that's why now they're outwardly disrespectful to black women and things like that.
I don't really resent my mother for anything. She made the choices that she made, and she's basically trying to get over those choices even to this day. But it's like, something I don't necessarily get. I love my mother. She frustrates the piss out of me. But being frustrated isn't necessary. You can be frustrated with someone and still love them. So it means it's just like, I don't know. But I've also never been that type of person to like yell at somebody on the internet. It's like, I guess we kind of have the wrong group of people for stuff like that. Because it's like, but the thing about us is, I guess it's our responsibility to tell those who look like us. It's just like, hey, that's not cool. You shouldn't do that. It's probably not going to change them, though, is the ultimate problem. We need to have some type of more meaningful conversation. And these guys need to, like, honestly, they all need to deal with their damn anger and emotion issues.
Well, that was the point I was building to. Basically, for some reason, our men within our race they look down upon the women within our race compared to other women and things along those lines. And like you said, we need to have those conversations. We need to check each other about it. We need to be able to be like, hey, that's not cool. That's not something you do. That's not something you should ever do and pass those teachings along. It won't, just like anything else, any other issue we have, it can't be anything that's instantaneous, but you still have to start taking those steps towards the situation, trying to make that better and actually holding people accountable for the shit they do. It's like somebody out here hitting on somebody, don't, whatever you feel you need to do to rectify the situation. I don't fuck with you no more, or this, that, and the third, or had a conversation with them. Do something. Don't just, like, let it be a thing.
Other thing, like, I don't know. If a woman says no to you, be okay with it. It's not like your entire honor or everything has been stripped away from you because she doesn't want to date you.
Or she doesn't want to give you her number. When it comes to, well, that's just masculinity in general. When it comes to ego and pride, I can't even tie that within our race alone. But
but I'm more so worried about us.
I know, I understand that.
If we fix it within us, maybe it'll bleed out. Probably not, but
I doubt that. Regardless, like I said, we can focus back in just on us. Doesn't change the fact that it's still ego and pride situation, that when you get into something where a woman tells you no, you felt like she didn't have the right to tell you no. You felt like for some reason you have some type of betterment over that person, and you felt like they should just acknowledge you and praise you, and you say something, that's what it should be. No, that's not how it goes. Everyone's their own separate person. She had the right to tell you no. You should be able to accept that, like you said. And go about your business.
Because you're going to get a lot of no's before you get the yes that you want.
People going to tell you no. It's part of life.
It's like, I don't think anybody should have to massage your ego or anything like that in order to be like, oh, well, I have a boyfriend. I mean, hell, the story that we were watching yesterday that was a pivotal thing inside of this conversation. Well, she says he had a boyfriend. So what do you do? I'm going to hit her with this skateboard.
Like I said, I would have hit him with the skateboard.
It's just like, what the fuck is wrong with you? And it's also always interesting for the people who surround these things.
Like all of his friends, like that whole group of people, their friends that were just standing there laughing, it's like, something's wrong with all of y'all. What? Like, all of y'all gotta go.
Like,
it's some type of men that we don't need.
Right.
I don't know. Shit is fucked up. You look like you're stuck on the thought, Charles.
It's just like, it's not a situation like that. I don't even know what I would do. It's just like, well, obviously he hit her with the skateboard, so I guess I have to hit him with the right cross, and he has to go down, and then I have to pick up the skateboard and then go apologize. And he doesn't get the skateboard back anymore. This is my skateboard.
Yeah, you can't. It's like, yeah, but I don't know. I think that at least calling it out, if we do that as like a group, it'll make that more normalized, and so more people will be comfortable in calling it out to other people, and maybe then those other people are inside of groups of people that have friends or family members that engage in that behavior, and they'll feel comfortable in calling them out because they've seen other people do it. and like have a blueprint from doing it, whereas right now no one's saying shit. And so
you gotta do, you gotta start somewhere.
Yeah,
but yeah, and quintessentially is just like, I'm not saying you have to treat every single woman like how you treat your mother, because not every single woman is your mother, but you have to, I guess, have some of that bleed over, because that's a weird thing. Dudes treat their mothers completely and totally different than they treat most of the women inside of their lives.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it's just like, maybe you want to bleed some of that over. And like, that's all I really got on that now. I feel like we had other things to say yesterday, but it's... Now, inside of this situation, I have more exact situations where I can look at something and say, we did this wrong. This is how we should do it.
Yeah, I feel like yesterday we didn't have answers, and today we have more answers of, like, what we should be doing and everything like that.
Right.
Also, don't be what?
Also, don't be a colorist.
Yeah.
It's like...
Yeah, oh, also, that's something that I heard. Don't only defend the women that you're attracted to, and then be okay with blatant disrespect of women that you find less than attractive. Like, that's the thing, that guys will come and defend attractive women and things like that, but women that they don't want to sleep with or have no like intentions with, they just don't like consider them at all. And that shouldn't be a thing either.
Yeah, that definitely shouldn't be a thing.
Yeah. And at some point, I guess if we're gonna do this, you're gonna end up in- Like, I can understand being conflict-averse when it comes to dealing with this, because if you enter into a situation like this, you're going to get into an argument.
Yeah.
Like, you are. And you kind of have to be
just ready,
okay
for
with that. It was like... Because it's one of those things where the behavior... I guess the difference between being a man and being a boy, the behavior that we are directly addressing is that of a boy. It's someone who doesn't really have a proper amount of who doesn't have like a perception of respect and how people should be treated. And like, I kind of always view that as childlike behavior. It's just like, yo, this is childlike behavior. You need to chill on this. And here's how you can correct it. And it's not going to be an instantaneous thing, but.
Yeah. Yeah, no, it's not going to be instantaneous. It's going to take dedication, work, and a group effort of people being focused on it. But I think it's something that's important. So,
But unfortunately, like, we can do what we can, but we are also all three people who are fairly asocial when it comes to things.
Yeah.
So we are not going to be the people who are actually really getting out there, who are capable of seeing these things, because the places I go, I don't really see it.
Yeah, and I'm not really in places like that. Like, I don't go to the bars or the clubs and things like that where I would feel like you have a big chance of seeing it like randomly happen.
Mm-hmm.
I'm at the house or at work or going to grab some food and coming back to the house.
Yeah, it was just like,
but we will do what we can. But other than that, I don't think I have anything else.
The only other critique I would say inside that situation is that we also all need to spend time with our younger generations, because that's a way that we can also make sure this happens. Because if you teach the younger generation to do it, then eventually these things will be mitigated as time goes on, because hopefully they'll pass on those traits. That's all I got.
One would hope.
Right.
One would hope. But this has been Conscious Reconstruction with the round two of all of this good shit. See how much we care about you? We came back in after the fire to give you another episode. Smell the smoke on the walls still. The char on the floor. But we're in here. All right. Make sure you like, subscribe. Ash should be back next week. And we out. Gang, gang.